But, you know, whatever you want to get into.
Well, sex scandals aside, we're live. This is Eric Tries to Our Podcast, episode 114. I am here with Matt Saincome, the all of your what are all your titles at the hard times? Creator, editor-in-chief?
I usually just say founder.
Founder, okay.
I pretty much have a lot of different, so I mean, on different days, I'm like a Photoshop, you know, grunt or whatever. Like, I just try to plug in the holes of whatever we need. So right now I do editor-in-chief stuff, but honestly, you know, a lot of the, like, editing stuff really is Bill Conway. He's the managing editor. So I'm doing a lot of, like, you know, rubber stamping and directional stuff, like guiding the publication, but Bill Conway and my brother Ed and I kind of have an editorial meeting where we guide the product together, and so my editing, you know, involvement has, like, been reduced a little bit because I've been doing a little bit more stuff that would be, like, more like kind of like the role of, like publisher, and then as far as the company's controlled, like, concerned, like, managing member of an LLC, like, taking care of, like, the business side of things.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like, from what I gathered, which is all, you know, just tangential, not whatever, outskirts knowledge, it sounds like you're handling kind of the big picture stuff, and Bill, who I had on a few episodes past, it handles some of the more day-to-day editing stuff. Is that kind of the dynamic? Okay, cool.
Yeah, so, I used to be the music editor at SF Weekly, I was the music editor at my college paper. I was the editor in chief of my high school yearbook and the editor of a punk scene. So I have experience in that area. So I kind of like help with the big picture editorial questions. Obviously, when we first started, I was, you know, right in the trenches all the time. But now I kind of Bill's really really he's really smart. He's a quick learner. So like I kind of tell him, you know, what certain stylistic things to do, and then he kind of works in a role that I normally used to do. So he kind of is like, he does a lot of the big editing stuff, and now I take like care of like a lot of the business stuff. Like, there's certain things that happen, like regarding like percentages that an advertising company gives you, or the rate that you pay for hosting, or like we have a couple partnerships coming up, and like how those partnerships work out, and then even just like kind of like the legal side of things. Like, there shouldn't be a big legal side of things, but there is whenever you're like publishing things. I had to take like I was a journalism major in college, so I had to take like a media law class, right? So like there's certain steps that you take if you're gonna be publishing things on the internet to help protect yourself, because I mean, you like see what happened with Gawker, right? Like,
yeah, Jesus, we don't,
it's not like we have any money for Hulk Hogan to take, but if we ever do, I don't want Hulk Hogan to take it. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah, that's reasonable.
Yeah.
That's reasonable. So, yeah, that actually brings me to, so on the podcast, I like to kind of dive into how, like, a lot of my guests are up-and-coming comics, musicians, whatever it is. You happen to be running an extremely popular and very hot and just very well-produced website. So you kind of have just kind of that extra thing where you've got something going on right now. But I still, with you, I definitely want to kind of dive into some of the early stuff of how you got involved in this. And that brings me to, like, I'm definitely going to ask you about punk and hardcore. I want to ask you about comedy. I want to ask you about journalism. But with the business stuff, I am kind of, like, you're a young guy.
Mm-hmm.
How was it just school that prepared you for the business side of this? Because you were thrust into... Sounds like you set it up very well from what I heard on Jesse Cannon's podcast.
Like the business side was a lot of learning on the fly. When I first started the website, I did not think that business would ever even really be something that we have to even talk about. But then it started to, you know, the numbers started to creep up to the point where it could become a business. And it should become a business. And then it started getting to a point where I was at my desk at SF Weekly, and something would happen in the punk world, and people would be like, you know, what's the hard times going to say about this or whatever? And I was working, you know, honestly, I was working like 11 or 12 hours at SF Weekly. It was a very demanding job. And then I'd come home, and I'd work, you know, 3 or 4 hours in the hard times. And it got to a certain tipping point where I realized, you know, this thing is blowing up, and I need to be there to give it every single thing that I have. So what I did was I saved up some money at SF Weekly, and I just, you know, I quit. And I said, I'm going to do hard times full time. So I've been doing that every day since then. I think that was like 6-ish months ago. And so on the business side of things, I had to learn very quickly. I got a lot of help. I used to be a freelancer for Noisy. And the editor-in-chief there, his name is Fred, and he's a hardcore dude. And I kind of let him know what was happening in my career. He's a friend of mine, and he kind of started giving me advice, and then I gave him a tiny piece of the company and made him officially an advisor. And so he used to run his own website, and he bought a website once, and he sold the website, I think. I don't know how he got out of it. He has friends. He's friends with the guy who runs Brooklyn Vegan, and he put me in touch with him, and I had a long phone conversation with him, and I talked to him all about it. And I just kind of learned, you know, through my network of journals and friends, and reading some business books, how to run the business side of things, and trial.
That's fascinating, because not only are you so young, but you just got thrown into this. That's really cool that you had such a good network, and it's understandable how you'd have those connections. Like, you've obviously been doing this for a long time.
Well, I guess Ed and I, you know, Ed and I ran a record company for our band. You know, this is obviously very small scale. You know, but you know, we started getting into things like, you know, how much money you put into something and how much money you get out of it. And I was in charge of the budget when I was in high school of a yearbook, which doesn't sound like a big deal, but the budget was like $300,000 a year or something, because I came from a fancy high school. I've been doing things like that for a little while, where I've been in charge of things. And when I was in college, I was like a semi-professional poker player, which had a lot to do with like risk versus reward. And I thought I was going to be I thought maybe about being an econ minor, so I definitely took some econ classes and learned about things like opportunity cost and, you know, supply and demand, basic things like that. So I figured it out. I think we're doing really, really well as far as that stuff is concerned, which is great because, as you know, we're able to pay all of our writers, which is like...
Which is insane.
For me, I was a freelance writer full-time for a little while, which didn't work out well because it's fucking hard to do. But to be able to pay other people to put stuff up on my website is like, it really is like a point of pride for me. So when I go into like business negotiations or how to figure out the business, that's definitely like one of the main things on my mind is how can we do better so that we can pay people better, so that we can increase content, increase the satisfaction of our writers, get them more motivated. So I would say that's one of the main things that I'm interested in.
Yeah, absolutely. And that seems very... It was interesting. Like, I did a little bit of attempting freelance for crack.com back in, like, 2010, 11. Got a lot of things, like, you know, the this close. And a couple things published, but none of the, like, front page stuff. Uh-huh. But it was, like, I knew what people were getting paid. And that's, they would pay, if you got a front page article, they'd pay you $50 an article.
Yeah, that's not very good. I mean,
and for their traffic and for their brand, and that's why when I saw what you were able to do, I was like, holy! In comparison, I was like, holy shit!
I'm hoping my goal is by the end of the year to definitely be able to pay people more than SF Weekly, just as a point of pride again, just to be able to say, hey, I can pay people now more than what I. Yeah, but it's interesting. I mean, one of the things that I did was I kind of like when I was at SF Weekly. I kind of like looked around at what everyone was doing, and I would constantly ask like all my coworkers, even the ones who were in the same department as me, like what their job was. I'd be like, what do you do related to ads? What do you do related to, you know, social media? What is your job? Can you explain to me what you're doing? And trying to create some sort of like bare bone replication of that, but like slimmed down and more efficient. And I think that we've gotten off to a pretty good start. When I was a freelance writer, I wrote when I was an intern, I wrote an article for SF Weekly. I was an intern at SF Weekly before I was a music editor, and it was about a guy who had sex with a dolphin, right? So my editor, he wrote a book about it. Is it really? I'll send you the link. Anyways.
Yeah, please do. Can you send it to like my alternate Gmail account?
It's called Wet Goddess is the name of the book. Anyways, my editor was like, Matt, there's a guy, he sent this email, he wrote a book about having sex with a dolphin, you should call him up and interview him. And I thought, okay, well, from a comedic angle, it'd be way funnier if I went and met this guy in person and was able to detail it, right? There's that middle in this apartment, it was kind of sketchy, but the article that I wrote went all over the world, like just super viral. Like, I remember just watching the Facebook shares climb and climb and climb, and I think I was cleaning out my garage to throw a punk show with my band, and I think my mom was over, and I was hanging out with my brother Ed, and we were cleaning out the garage, and I was like checking my phone constantly, like, oh my god, it's up to 5,000 shares, 10,000 shares, 15,000 shares. And then I got like an email the next day from my editor, and they're like, you know, we had this meeting and the article did so well. It's the best shared, best viewed article of the entire year for the whole website. And you should write a follow-up, and you should do this, and you should do that. And there was all this congratulation. The different editor there said, hey, man, I want you to do that, but for my section. Right? And I got paid $35. And I kept thinking, well, I was the one who did this, right? Like, I brought a camera, I took the photo, I wrote the story, I went to the guy's house, I paid the gas to get there. And I was like, well, then I should just be the guy who owns the website. And so that's... So over the course of the next couple of years, I plotted and planned, and then now that's what I do.
Oh, that's awesome. I love that. That's a great story.
So it all comes down to dolphin sex. Let me just tell you that right off the bat.
Hold on. I've been taking notes. Let me get this down. Sex. I swam with them. That was the closest I've come. There was bathing suits, the whole thing. Like, yeah, $35. What'd you spend the $35 on?
I don't even know. I definitely at one point, I won't say what company it was, I freelanced for a variety of companies. I definitely got a check for $12. Are you still there?
Yeah. Can you not see me?
Okay. No, sorry, my Mac did something. I got a check for $12 in the mail, and it bounced, and then my bank charged me $20. And I was like, all right, well, that's just, you know, I had to spend like 4 hours on the article or something like that. Freelancing is very, very hard. I would certainly like to get our freelance rates up to at least SF Weeklies, and then, you know, continue to push it. You've already seen in our group, you know, some of our sponsored posts are, you know, a decent bit higher than SF Weeklies, and that's because I'm able to do that because the people are paying us for the article or whatever. And I'd like to kind of increase the average. Is my goal is to get that average number way up, but you know, we'll see how it goes.
With those sponsored ones, I love how. Well, actually, this is across the board for everything at the site. So sorry if I compliment you too much. I know a lot of people in this business are not comfortable with that. Like, the direction that you help skew, that you do skew the site, specifically with the sponsored ones, it's you were very clear. This is not an advertisement. This is a quality article that happens to be able to incorporate, you know, the bot post. And that makes perfect sense. And going off of that, they were like I do podcasts. I've been doing comedy writing for a while, like usually either for other comics or for like scripts. I do a lot of punch up for like, and it's cool. I've met a lot of cool people doing that.
Yeah.
But like, and recently I started doing stand up. Every single one of those things has been drastically improved by maybe three posts that you made helping direct things. Cool. And like you incorporate one or two little tips in, and I was like, oh, that's right. That's how this should be done. So from me to you, thank you for that. But also, like, how did you, coming from someone who, well, first off, what is your comedy background, whether it's what you've done or what you've just enjoyed of it, but also how, coming from not a strict comedy background, how are you able to break it down to such a...
So that's an interesting question. I don't have a comedy background, flat out. I am like a goofball though, so I am constantly telling jokes every day. Bill Conway has a comedy background, so a lot of times when it does get down to the fine details of how a joke works or doesn't work, Bill Conway is the guy that we lean on, and he's very talented in that department, which is why he's got put into his role. But what I do know how to do is to guide and polish ideas. And when I have a writer, right, so if I'm in an editor position, and I have a writer, my goal is to take whatever their idea was and help them with it to make it stronger and funnier and better and polish it up and ready to post, and then also to help them avoid certain pitfalls. The way that I know how to do that is that I've been in the other position. I've been a writer a whole bunch of times, and I still am. And so I had people like at SF Weekly. My editor was a guy named Mark Kemp, and he was a super talented editor, and he would go through every single line of my stories, and he would say, you know, you're losing your narrative here. There's no reason for you to include this here. You need to rewrite this. You need to call this person back. And he's a super talented music journalist, and learning from him, learning from guys like Fred, I kind of developed a sense of how to become an editor. I also think that editing is... I think it's also kind of has a lot to do with social skills, like interpersonal communication skills, which I think some people don't... Some editors don't get that. Like, I've certainly worked with some editors who can, like, disrespect or demoralize their writers to the point where they, you know, they lose control of the situation. So it's interesting because I think that the one of the reasons why our site does well is actually because I'm not a comedian. I know it sounds weird, but I think the a lot of stuff has to do with online publishing, has to do with like news judgment, which is something you learn in journalism school. Like, what should you write about, right? I think sometimes a lot of comics don't have news judgment skills. Like,
yeah, what was the funny thing that popped into my head? I'll say it. But yeah, exactly. Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
So it's like they will talk about anything. Sometimes it works really well in the comedy world, but if you're talking about like online publishing, what do you have to engage with other conversations that are going on in public and comment on them. And so as a journalist, I was trained to do that, right? And then Bill is trained to like make jokes about things. So we kind of like combine that together a little bit. And I think that's where some of our success comes from.
I was going to ask you, well, quick aside, because you just brought it up, with the social skills and being able to give feedback but not disrespect or criticize in a destructive way, you were the singer of your band. Do you also play an instrument or no?
I play drums. I haven't in a long time, though.
Yeah. Well, when you're the singer, like, I cannot sing. I can yell, but I can't sing to save my life.
Well, same,
but, like,
same here.
Every, you know, but, like, every band I've been in, I'm usually writing the songs, and sometimes that involves the vocals and the lyrics. But I always have to, and I found that the singers in some of the bands I've been in have had a very difficult time, and you know, sometimes I have too, of communicating without disrespecting when you're trying to work out ideas. Because of your experience in the band, do you think that's helped you with those skills?
I mean, you know, like, really? I think it's probably, I think like collaborative team efforts is definitely true, but I've certainly pissed off plenty of band members before, so I don't know if I can like take that claim. I would say that working as a group to create a finished product is something that I've done pretty much my entire life, including bands, which probably does help. There's certainly a certain kind of editor where it's like, you know, writers are like kind of like super introverted. There's like that kind of stereotype, like at the coffee shop, like working on their screenplay or whatever. I'm not one of those people, so I do think that sometimes that helps my editing abilities, and I've had some of my writers tell me that before. I think one of the main things with a big collaborative project, including bands, like let's say you have to go on tour, is to like divvy up responsibilities. Like, so
how do you do that? I've literally done everything for how do you do that?
Well, so okay, so like a lot of times that's how you divvy it up, is, you know, not too many people involved. But like, so like when my band used to go on tour, like Ed would book the dates. I would do like the merch design. And you know what I mean? So you kind of like go through, or I would call the studio guy to record, to book the recording time. You have to divide things up. I think that's true for all sort of projects.
I bet that helps you learn how to find people's strengths, which is definitely a big key in managing.
Yeah. I'm managing people's, it can be difficult at times. When I became an editor at SF Weekly, I had to fire someone who was like twice my age and did not like the fact that that was happening. So I don't know. I certainly have. Sometimes I'm good at it. Sometimes I'm not.
Yeah. All right, well, you had mentioned how you bring the journalism background, and Bill has the comedy background. Now I was going to ask you this from minute one. Do you believe in serendipity? Because the combination of the profession, like the business part of it, the journalism, the comedy, plus no one had really done I hate making this comparison because it almost negates the uniqueness of the site, but a punk onion, whatever you want to call it, hadn't been done, and especially hadn't been done to such an extent. And then it also happened right before this giant boom of satire sites. Like, everybody wants to have a satire site. Everyone's sharing these satire posts like I've never seen before. All that happened at, like, the exact right time in the right way.
Yeah, that is interesting. I don't really know. Okay, so I was trying to figure out, like, was that boom of satire sites, was that something that that I was thinking, like, maybe because I started a satire site, these things started coming to me. You know how you kind of like create your own world or like your own network of friends? Like, I was thinking maybe that was what was happening. But then, like, Vice hit me up, and they were trying to write some article called, like, The Rise of Fake Clickbait or something like that. It ended up getting canned for some reason, but they were talking about how these sites were getting more and more popular. I don't really know what that has to do with anything. I know for sure that I can tell, I'm not going to say their names, but I know for sure there's at least one or two people who were directly trying to rip us off. But I don't know. I don't know what that is about. I don't think that it was happenstance as far as creating this particular type of site, because what the one thing that I have been able to do is, because I've been doing like punk comedy writing, weirdly enough, like since like high school, because my zine was all humor, and then my band was on stage. I used to play a character who was a humor thing.
I watched videos before I knew that, by the way. It took me a couple videos before I was like, oh, he's fucking with them.
Yeah. I still have some issues related to things like that. Anyways, so I think I realized as I started writing for different companies and became an editor at one, and I started looking at, you know, I was able to look at different people's stats and talk to managing editors about what was going on. Started to realize that there was like sort of like a gap in the landscape. So I had this idea for this site, and I was like, I'm going to do this site. And I told some people, and they're like, that's just like The Onion. And weirdly enough, like, because I don't really come from a comedy background, like, I was like kind of like superficially knowledgeable of The Onion, but I didn't really know too much about it. So then I really like dove deep into their archives once people started telling me more and more that I was a fucking idiot trying to steal The Onion's idea. And
satire, their idea.
So yeah, so I looked at it, and I was like, you know, obviously I was blown away. I was like, this is like some of the best, funniest headline writing I've ever seen. And then, but I did notice like there's a lot of like articles about like putting your kids to sleep or mowing your lawn or like all these like, or like what your grandkid does and stuff. And I was like, there's no way that I can relate to that. So the site that I'm going to make is going to be all about like people like you and me, or people like who play in bands, or people who like are into tattoos and like just alternative people. It's like an alternative Onion is pretty much what I didn't really want it to ever be a punk Onion. I think the shortest way that I summed it up was it was going to be the Vice Onion is what I was saying. And what was really cool about that is about a year after I started it, both Vice and The Onion reached out to us to want to become business partners. And I was like, hey, those are exactly what I had in mind. Perfect. So hell yeah. So there was apparently a hole in the hole in the landscape, and we crushed it.
Exactly. And that's the thing is, because I was, long before I ever started like submitting any pitches, even that initial email, like last summer or whatever, I was a huge fan of the site, but I would see these articles and go, this is genius, but nobody but me and maybe 100 other people are going to get it, because it's so specific to a culture, to a lifestyle, to a knowledge base. And it was, you know what, it was unapologetically good, because it was like, we're not going to pander or like, or only talk about the surface level. We're going to get to the nitty-gritty. You have to... I can't explain a single one of these headlines on the hard times to anybody in my family. I have to explain 6 references before they even fully understand. And the fact that it was just like, no, who gives a shit if this is like... But it's good. It's good over... Whatever, quality over quantity for whatever. And I think that's a big reason why.
Hey, that's cool. You said you should become our mascot. You should just go around telling people that, like, it's so fucking good. No,
I've had enough hard times people on this that I've heard.
Yeah, I think the thing about like kind of making jokes that other people wouldn't understand is like, we do that honestly just because like it's who we are. If you go on tour in a punk band and you meet all the different people and you see all the bands, you like, these are jokes that we all make kind of as a community, and so they connect to a certain type of person and they don't connect to other... My girlfriend sent me... She came around my house one time and she was like, hey, I saw your article did really well today. I didn't get it. you know...
The picture looked nice.
You know, yeah, it was like... There's like 2,000 shares on it or whatever, and she just literally had no idea what it was, which is kind of good and kind of bad. I personally like it that way. We ran a joke today that literally you would only understand if you had seen a Gnostic Front live and if you had heard about Nick Jonas's guitar solo. So you had to understand those two things. And in our editorial meeting, that headline came up. My brother Ed pitched it. And I was like, that's funny. Let's do it. And Bill was like, will anyone get that? What are you talking about? Is the guitar solo quiet? Like, he didn't... I guess he's never seen the Gnostic Front live. I love Gnostic Front. They're one of my favorite bands of all time. But if you've seen them live, you can see that, you know, his solos are not loud enough.
Okay.
So, I don't know. Is it good to make jokes like that? I think sometimes it's worth it. So,
well, that's the some of the funniest, like, I forget it. I don't know if this is a real term or just something I heard one time and figured it was a real term, but, like, one percenter jokes where it was like 1% of the audience is going to get it, but it's going to be the joke that sticks with them forever.
So, and, like, when we post that one on Twitter or whatever, like, Frank Turner, who I'm a big fan of his music, he retweeted, and he's like, this is the best website on the internet. And I tweeted back on him, and I was like, you would only understand this joke if you, like, have seen Agnostic Front and you saw that Nick Jonas thing. And he's like, it's perfect. It's like, that's a perfect underrepresented market. I don't know. Yeah, it's weird. I don't know how it works.
It's funny. By the way, Frank Turner keeps getting brought up. The episode I published today with Sue Werner from a band called War on Women, she told a whole story about, like, hanging out with him. And I was like, I have not heard this much Frank Turner in, like, years.
I first heard Frank Turner when I was on tour. We were driving through Canada, and my brother put him on, and I just really, really liked him right off the bat. So it was really sick when I became, like, a really big fan of his music and went through, like, his whole discography and listened to all of it, and then I heard that he liked the site. I was like, there's been a couple moments like that where I'm like, that's just cool, dude, because, like, if you grew up, like, the first type of music that I ever liked was punk, which is kind of weird, but it has a lot to do with, like, my older brother and the group of friends I was hanging out with, but if you listen to a certain type of music since you're literally in elementary school, and then you start, you know, being able to hang out with or talk to all the people that you listen to their music, like, it's, and then they say, like, hey, man, yeah, like, you meet them and they're like, I'm a fan of your stuff. And you're like, oh, that's sick. I don't know.
Yeah, that's crazy. Yeah, that's insane. Yeah. So what was the first punk record that you heard, and what about it, like, really attracted you to it?
I think one of the first punk bands that I was into was, like, I want to say, like, it was probably, like, Catch 22, which was ska, but, and then, like, I think, like, the Ramones. You know, I was talking to
something other. Was it Keys Midnights, or was it a later Catch 22 album?
It was Keys Midnights, yeah.
Thomas Kalmacki is my favorite songwriter, I think, period.
Yeah, I'm still, like, I listen to Streetlight Manifesto, like, once a week.
One
thing I was talking about with someone else was, because I was really into the Ramones as a kid, like, my AOL AIM screen name was, like, the Ramones 1-2-2. Anyways, like the Ramones, they kind of created their own thing by, like, poorly imitating someone else. A lot of musicians have done that over the course of, you know, music history. It's like they're trying to do something, but this, like, doesn't turn out, make it their own. I think that's something, like, the Hard Times is doing, where it's like we're trying to do satire, but because, like, we have, like, a journalism base and, like, a unique punk perspective, it just kind of gets all blended together, and it comes out in a way that is unique and fun, and separates us from other people.
Like, yeah. And that's what I've heard from just people who, like, most of my friends are into the site, just big fans of the site. And
have you come across anyone who's just straight up hated you because you're involved with it? Because there's those people, too.
It's weird because, like, the only people who I've really told were, like, you know, when I shared the article that I had go, that's the only time I'm like, oh yeah, I'm involved. Except for, like at comedy, every once in a while, somebody will, like, just bring up the Hard Times, and I'll, of course, just be like, because I want them to like me. I try very hard. I was like, yeah. Oh, I wrote an article for that. But unfortunately, I haven't had anybody, like, come up and just, like...
Next time they bring up something about the Hard Times, just say, like, what do you think about that? Say with that, and then get an honest advice, or honest question. So one time, when I was a music editor at SF Weekly, my calendar editor, John, he actually does the copy editing on the weekends for the Hard Times now, but he turned to me and he said, Matt, because I was a music editor, and he used to give me, like, a lot of advice on what I should write about, because he's like, he knows everything about San Francisco. He was like, yeah. Matt, have you heard about this Hard Times thing? Like, it's, like, blowing up. Everyone's talking about it. And I was like, yeah, I've heard of it. What do you think of it? He's like, it's funny. It's pretty good. I think they're around here. Like, that's probably someone who you should interview. And I was like, yeah, man, I'll think about it. I also run that site. he was like, no, you don't, man. Shut up. Well, like, that is, yeah, I do.
Yeah.
That was weird.
Well, the thing I keep hearing, like, everyone's always loved the headlines, and now more and more it's just like, but did you read the article?
Yeah.
It's like that, because a lot of times people don't, like, the Onion does a lot of business by just sharing headline or selling products that have no article, that just are compilations of headlines.
I don't really I've never been a fan of how The Onion writes a headline and has a picture and then you click and there's nothing there. I think that's partially like a journalism instinct of mine, but like I feel like if I click on your site, you should give me something. So like yeah. When it's come up a couple times, some people have been very upset, but some people wanted us to go along that route, and I was like, you know what, honestly, like, no. I want people to think that, okay, the hardline headlines are funny, and if I click, I get another laugh. You know, at least one more laugh is the goal. So it's interesting because The Onion certainly has adopted some sort of strategy where they do that from time to time, and I love the Onion, and I love their headlines, but I will admit I do give them like what we call like the headline treatment sometimes, which is like you don't click, and people do that with us too, and it does like it affects like our stats and our business, and like we try to think about ways around it, but at the same time we don't fight it because like we have an Instagram where we just put up all the headlines, so it's like if you're literally just interested in the headlines, like you don't need to engage with our brand, you don't need to click anything, you can just we're just gonna give them to you because we really do just want people to laugh and have a good time. It was one of the main things like that started the website was like, I don't know, I turned out to be a philosophy minor, and I started to think about, like, what I was doing in the world, and, like, if I was helping anyone, and I started to think about how, like, the only thing that I've ever really been good at is, like, writing and making people laugh, and I was like, making people laugh is kind of, like, a worthwhile effort.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And if you look at a lot of the hard times, like, if you're an administrator on the page, you can like click on the shares that from each article, and you can read what people are saying about it. And I do it pretty frequently.
Oh, cool!
And I've seen so many people who are like, "Dude, I was in the hospital today, and this like cheered me up." Or like, I've had a really hard week, and someone in my family died, and I was crying, and this just really makes it all like I'm like this gives me strength to continue on my day. And I'm like, that's really like that's really really rewarding. So
that's damn right it is. Jesus, yeah.
Yeah.
So I had no idea it was that. I mean, the ones that crawl across my screen are just like, holy shit.
The most famous comment is like literally me. That's me. But there are like sometimes like when David Bowie died and we did like a kind of like tribute to him. There are people like I've been crying all day, but this like made me like better and blah blah blah. I don't know. I get a real kick out of that stuff.
Well, the one the Heaven now has. Formed its super group or whatever, that article did insane from what I could tell.
It was pretty crazy. It crashed our website several times.
Really? Jeez. Yeah. Well, it was so crazy because, like, well, that one, it was like the sentimentality almost took a front seat to the humor. It was funny, but it was like, it was cathartic. Like, just reading it, it's just like, that's. Everybody gets a happy ending. We can all feel like I don't know. Yeah. We can feel almost whole again after losing so many monumental people in music. And after all, the site is so rooted in music that it makes perfect sense. And
I think like our kind of like our readership or community kind of needed something like that. There's kind of like a deeper when articles do well. I always think there's like sometimes our funniest articles don't do that well, but I feel like when articles do really well. There's usually like a deeper reason to it. Like it's not really just about like the article or the headline or the photo. Like those things are funny, they connect. But a lot of times people share things like because they want to be represented by them, or they want to tell their friends that this is how they feel, or they want to like maybe there's a cathartic reason, or maybe there's like a hateful reason or an angry reason. But there's usually like a different emotion. Like share is one button, but there's like different emotions that you can tap into. So I guess sometimes. I think when I think of editing, I think of it as there's certain types of editing. There's editing like you dig into the words and you say, hey man, like your kicker's not good enough or your lead's kind of you need to straighten this out. But then there's also the editing like what's the point of this article? What's its place? Who does it connect with? Those sorts of things are kind of like the big picture things that we sometimes do really well on. Sometimes we miss, but. Yeah.
Well, by the way, the consistency rate is just so high. Like that's what's absurd. Well, like I think part of going back to the Onion thing about the headlines only. I mean, I assume a lot of that is timeliness based, where they're like, we just need to get this up. It's breaking news, and we want to make sure that. And I could be wrong about that, but from what I've seen, that's typically the majority of the headline only ones. But with hard times, not only. Can you kind of wait a little bit for it? You don't have to like be as timely as like, because if the Onion is trying to make Onion sometimes tries to, a lot of sites. I shouldn't single Onion out because they're fucking geniuses. And who am I to say? But like, there a lot of these other satire sites will be like, okay, who's the first to get the obvious joke out, or who's the first to get the second most obvious joke out? But with hard times, it seems like it's always what's our take? What's the take that nobody else is doing? So you can buy yourself some time because nobody else has beaten you to that punch. Nobody has beaten you to the man's tattoo reminds him of the time he stabbed a panther in the face. No one's beating you to that
That's one of my favorite headlines. That was Mark Turner. He's
I love Mark's stuff.
I think like when we go into the editorial room, we think a lot about how we don't want to write a headline that's just like the first comment on the story of or on the actual story, you know, because you're like satirizing an actual story. There's a lot of like, it's like when like Jared from Subway gets, you know, in trouble or whatever. There's a lot of like foot long jokes. We really don't want to be a fucking website that runs foot long jokes, you know. So there is like kind of like a panic to the timeliness stuff where you want to make a joke that's good, that's your own, that hasn't been made, but is also like still topical and still it's kind of. I think of it like a kind of like a bell curve or something like that, or like a wave of like of relevancy. And if you're on, if you're going to be like a day or two late, then you need to increase the quality of the joke. If you're going to hit it right when it comes out, the truth is that, you know, it doesn't need to be the greatest joke in the world, because if you're engaging with a giant public conversation, then that's going to carry it. It's going to add a momentum. So we do both, and we consider. Okay, can we get this joke out right now? If not, if we can get it out tomorrow, how good does it need to be? Blah, blah, blah. It's kind of like a complicated... I think about that sort of stuff a lot.
Yeah.
Well, and then at the end, and at the end, we run a dick joke.
Exactly, yes. Oh, man. At the end, it's... What is the... I love this one, but the ducklings crossing the pit.
So that joke was so interesting, right? Because I didn't get it at all. Like, I was
so absurd.
I was like, I don't get this joke. And then Ed in our editorial meetings, he kept bringing it up like week after week, because he Stephen pitched that like it was like 3 months old by the time it ran, because Ed just kept bringing it up. He's like, guys, I think we need to run this duck story, and it fucking just exploded. Like, people love that duck story, and then I looked at it and I was like, I do like this too.
Well, there's nothing to get. You don't get it because there's nothing to get. It's preposterous. And
by the time it got published, there was like a whole thing about like. I think there's like a critique of like punks caring about things that are kind of like inconsequential or something like that. Or, like there was kind of like a little bit of something in there, but it was mostly just an absurdist joke. But there's a lot of different styles of humor, and we run a bunch of different kinds of humor on our page based on who pitches it. But it all has to go through our editorial process, so I think a lot of it is like similar. One thing that's interesting is when we're talking. I was talking to someone about like styles of humor or something like that, and my mom told me a story about myself that I think I was probably late elementary school, and my parents decided right off the bat, listen, this kid's scrawny, he's not going to be an athlete, so we got to send him to some sort of like artsy class or something. So they sent me to comedy school or something like that.
Really?
And I guess I went one day. And I got back in the car and I told my mom, I'm not going to let other people tell me how to make jokes. And then I didn't go again. So, I don't know. I guess I was...
They didn't get what I was going for.
I was confident that I had it all figured out.
Oh, man. No, that's... Yeah, and that once I learned about your journalism piece, or like the piece, whatever, your journalism background, that was just like, it all clicked so much for the website. So what made you... Okay, so... Going back, what made you get into a band? Was it just your love of the music? Were you at any point really like, this, I think this is what I want my, you know, career to be? How does the band factor into the rest of all this? Or bands?
I never wanted it to be a career. I think the very first time I started a band, I'm trying to remember what our motive was. I think we were already like diehard punk rockers. I was like a street punk, and we like were really into that stuff. I think we were just really, really angry. It was like back when we were like graffitiing public property and running away from cops and blah, 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 like getting into fights or whatever. Like, so
I know those days.
So we wanted an outlet, I suppose. And we started a band, and we recorded like 30 songs or some shit, and then it's pretty funny. It was called Skull Stomp, and then eventually we recorded a bunch of songs, and we noticed that it was a three-piece, me, my friend Matt, and my friend Colin, and we noticed that Colin's voice was better or more interesting or something, And so we wanted him to be the front man. So I went into my older brother's room and I said, Ed, you have a bass player. You have a bass, right? And he's like, yeah, but I don't know how to play it. And you're like, we don't know how to play our instruments. So who gives a shit? Yeah. And then I like kind of tricked him. I was like, just practice with this one time, dude. Just practice with this one time. And eventually he practiced with us, and then we became a band. And then that band that band played for a while, and then someone quit over a girlfriend or something like that. And then I was really...
I've had people quit because their girlfriend didn't like
the podcast. Yeah, something like that. And then Zero Progress started. Yeah, I've been in a couple straight-edge bands. Now I play in a band called Pure. I don't know why I
played band. Straight edge band called Pure?
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
I've always played in bands. Since I've been, I guess probably 14 or 15, I've never had a time where I wasn't in a band. So I don't, you know, maybe, you know, you make me think about who I am as a person. I don't know, dude. I just, it's something I do.
Yeah, no, that's yeah, I always wanted to do... My dad's a professional musician. Like,
oh, yeah?
like a famous jazz guitarist. And nice. So like, I've always had the music around me.
Uh-huh.
And so I was like, oh, that's what I'll do. Like, uh-huh. That's like a reasonable profession to just decide you're going to do. And then I had like a huge wake-up call in my early 20s when I was like, oh, shit, you have to make money to do this.
Yeah, yeah, so... I definitely, my dad was is a huge record collector, so a lot of my musical stuff came from him and from my older brother. They were both very into music. But I never, even for a moment, thought that I was going to be a professional musician. I took some drum lessons, but, you know, I knew a couple beats, and I just played really quick, and then I became like a guy who just shouts angrily. And then, honestly, during the later end of Zero Progress, I became just like a satirical character who was just doing like stand-up and like skits on stage and then screaming angrily. So I didn't really ever think of that as a career path, but more of just like an outlet, creative outlet for anger and comedy and all those sorts of things that I like to do.
Yeah.
My friend Kevin is going to be a professional musician. He went to that Berklee College of Music or whatever.
Yeah.
He was always the most talented kid in our group. Him and Matt Berry. Matt Berry plays in the band Happy Diving.
Okay.
I don't know if you heard them. They're good.
I should have mentioned it. I've been in a pop punk band for 5 years. Like, I know that world inside and out. But
that sounds like a headline, dude. Just opinion. I've been in a pop punk band for 5 years.
opinion.
I was in my band for 5 years. I've never quit a band. Other people quit before I do, so I guess I'm kind of like overly committed and overly loyal. I'm like, dude, this next record, this is gonna be the one where we get a tour, man. We're gonna play so many sick shows. It's gonna be so much fun. It never happens, and I don't know what I'm thinking.
Were you always the leader of the bands, or just was...
My brother usually like runs the bands.
Much older is he?
He is three years older than me.
Three.
Yeah.
Yeah,
he usually runs a band. I'm usually the front man. This new band I play in, it's kind of more like a collaborative effort. No one really runs the band. I don't think it works very well because of that. But it's all right.
I've started doing like solo acoustic stuff where I just yell, and uh-huh. It has been the most stress free. Like, I've been in bands forever, just like you, and it's like, not having to deal with another person has been a real godsend. I'm very, very happy with that.
it's very interesting and difficult. When I guess for me, I'm the type of guy who I would like to play shows every weekend at like pizza shops or whatever. Like, I don't care.
Yeah.
And I always hated the bands that would like only play the big shows, right? And now I play in a band like that. So maybe I hate myself now. I'm not sure.
I had a lot less fun once we started, like, because we played this pop punk band, we played every show we could get our hands on, like once, mm-hmm. twice a week, whenever we could, and for years, and we promoted like it was a full-time job. We went crazy, and then, like, I guess a year and a half ago, we were just like, we're exhausted. Can we just, like, let's just play? And then we played just the big shows. But I gotta say, our live show is so much better than it's ever been.
It's a way better strategy to play less.
We're doing so much better, and like, but I'm like less happy with it. Like,
yeah, it's weird, dude. Like, so my other band, like, we would play, you know, twice a month or something like that, and it was like same basement, same garage or whatever. And then like the new band, we played less. less frequently because some of the other guys have other stuff going on. They have like they're like married or whatever. And like our first show was with the Cro-Mags, and we like play with Judge, and we just like and like we just like play like once every 3 months, like these super sick shows, and like it's not as satisfying for me because I'm kind of like a guy who like I really really love like hard work. I don't know why. But maybe I'm a bit of a workaholic. Like I work on the hard times like 12 hours a day. And if I'm in a band, I like to work on it really, really hard. But the band I work on now is like, you don't have to work that hard on it. I wish we worked a little harder, to be honest, but it's all right.
Well, yeah, that's actually, I'm not surprised you say that as far as being a workaholic. God, that's something I relate to. I don't remember the last minute I didn't do something that I was like, how can I advance my chances of having a creative career? Like, oh, I have five. And that's what I love. One thing I love about pitching hard times is, oh, I've got 5 minutes. That's how I'm going to spend that 5 minutes. Like, just think. But, like, also, I've learned to sleep on pitches. Holy shit, that works so much better. The next morning, you're just like, oh, that's garbage.
I write them down on my notepad on my phone, and then I look over them again, and then I kind of, like, twist them. I usually try to add, like, a little twist onto them. Like, I've noticed, like, there's, like, the main concept. Sometimes people pitch headlines that are just concepts, you know? And you take the concept, and you add, like, a little twist or something, like, a little bit of magic on top of it. That's when you really get, like, a headline that does really, really well.
I'm trying to figure out a middle ground. I'm always either having one idea or there's four ideas I'm trying to cram into, like, the smallest amount of syllables.
So, like, you know, Ray Martinez, he's in our group. He used to run a thing called Poser Alert, which was like just headlines. And he, people thought I was ripping him off, but I didn't even know about it. He ended up joining us, and he pitched one of our greatest headlines, which was new driving app, new Henry Owen driving app, because, you know, how hard it would be to get there in the 80s. And the great part about the headline is it's not just about, you know, some people would have pitched just like, Henry Rowan has a new driving app, right? And it's like kind of like this absurd, weird thing, right? But the twist is the driving app has Henry Rowan's personality, and it's like this, you know, that's the magic. And sometimes I feel like when I sleep on my headlines and then I spice them up a little bit the next day, that's when the magic comes in. And that's when you really have something where it's like, damn, that's, you know, doesn't get better than that.
Yeah. That's good. If anyone's listening here who is in that kind of business, that's a very good tip. Yeah. All right. Workaholic. The fact that timeliness, workaholic, and hard times. I've noticed whenever there's like a story that it's like instead of just running the first joke that comes that's timely, instead of running the first joke that comes up, I've noticed that you will just be like, all right, we're gonna try to do something on this tomorrow because that's when. So let's burn the midnight oil and figure it out. And that kind of, like, yes, I'm not surprised you say you're a workaholic when that's going on.
I think sometimes people, people have different approaches to that. But I'm the type of guy where if I believe in something and I like it, like, if, for example, it's a really good headline, I'll stay up, you know, and I'll edit it all night and I'll create the Photoshop myself and I'll format it all myself and I'll make sure it gets done if that's what needs to be done. It's been an interesting transitional period with me doing a lot of business stuff. So sometimes maybe I do 10 hours of business stuff a day, you know, and then maybe I'm a little burned out or something like that. But it is, the timeliness thing is honestly, I feel like it might be a little bit of a problem in the hard times because it's something maybe that I'm going to try to improve is maybe our ability to react with the same level of quality, but on more breaking news topics. So, like, I believe that there are some things that we let slide. Our editorial group knows about how much I complained about the fact we didn't run. Remember there was a time that guy stepped on that table at some stupid award? What band?
Oh, no, yeah, the Coldplay, the other band stepped on,
Yeah, so I was like, I really, really wanted to run a headline about that, but I was doing something, so I couldn't, like, just straight up do it myself. And I think Bill wasn't happy with the headlines that we had. And we didn't know enough about the Coldplay or whatever to make like a smart enough joke. Time passed by, you know, we keep on keeping on, you know, we got another joke the next day, blah, blah, blah. To most people, it's nothing, right? But for me, those are like kind of like little failures. And as we advance as an editorial group, it probably will be something that we work on.
I remember pitching to that, and the only one that I could come up with that I thought was even half decent was, I don't even remember what it was, but it required you to know what they were fighting about, which was a symbol of a record cover. You had to know what that ancient Egyptian symbol meant, and you had to know about Coldplay. And I was like, that's the only thing I can't forget.
So it's like, it's confusing, right? Because like, so we kind of have that reputation as a site to like make those sorts of jokes, but then like, you know, do you make those jokes? You know what I mean?
If
like,
I have to do heavy research.
Yeah,
no one else is gonna know it. Like
exactly. So it's like sometimes you know, then there's other timely topics that break, and I don't think that they have a big enough reach to comment on. So it's like a weird, delicate balance. But I do feel like I've heard a lot of people talk about like some comics have reached out to me and said, "Hey man, me and my friends, you know, have been running a site like that for 5 years. You know, we never caught on." And I don't think that it's because they're bad at comedy. Their comedy, I'm sure, is great. I think it's because they didn't go to journalism school like I did, and they didn't get the news judgment classes. And like I had to like take tests on that shit and stuff like about what impacts most people, what do people care about, what do they connect with, blah blah blah, all those sorts of things. And I think that is the combination of those two skills. I believe is like honestly is one of the biggest driving factors of our site's success, because we don't have, you know, if you look at stuff like our social media numbers or something like that, we outperform Vice.com, Noisy, SF Weekly, Apple Music all combined on a weekly basis regularly. And those companies have like social media mavens, they have strategies, they have big budgets, they sponsor posts, but all we have is like a really dedicated fan base and a fine-tuned sense of what they care about. So I think that is kind of like part of the magic sauce of what makes us something that people even know about, something that people care about, is just that news judgment combined with comedy. Yeah. I think the Onion is pretty much the king of that.
Absolutely.
If you look at their, you know, Onion has all those other owned and operated sites like Starwipe and Clickhole and all those sorts of
things. I know Clickhole, yeah.
So they have another one called Starwipe, and it's like pretty much like making fun of like TMZ or like People Magazine or like some, you know, those like celebrity gossip rags. And it's really funny. I've really gotten into Starwipe. I really like it. If you're a fan of comedy, I would recommend checking it out. Sure. But something that they struggle with is they continually reference these things that you would only understand if you read like the back pages of complete garbage, like fucking celebrity gossip sites. So like a lot of their social media stuff doesn't do very well, but it is really funny. So there definitely is a balance. Ed and I were talking about how like, you know, we think punk is super underground, but the truth is at in 2016, who doesn't know what a mosh pit is, or who doesn't know who Black Flag is, right? So, it is kind of underground, but honestly, not so much anymore. So many people know, there's been so many movies, there's been so much mass exposure to the culture that, you know, it's not really as like niche as it's made out to be. So I think that sort of has helped us too, because I think sometimes Starwipe and those guys are actually being more niche than we are referencing DIY basement shows. I really do believe that.
Oh, absolutely, and that's, I mean, you give something enough time. I mean, punk is one of those things that's actually like, I don't know, we're in the scheme of things, we're pretty young. So it's like, we haven't seen as many cycles as like somebody in their, you know, 40s and 50s of pop culture and of the, things fade in culture. Mm-hmm. Like things fade and very little is remembered. Punk is something that has continuously came back several times into mainstream exposure. And given enough time, you have all these people who are just like, no, that's, I know what that is. I think you're absolutely right about that.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's interesting. Part of the reason why I think punk never goes away is a lot of people in punk really hate the idea of trends, but I was thinking about it, and like trends kind of like, they kind of keep things alive, because everyone, like I remember when I was in high school or whatever, the big thing was like 80s hardcore revival, and that was in the hardcore scene or whatever, and that was, you know, my favorite style of music for whatever reason, maybe because I was part of a trend, I don't know. But so I've continued to kind of go along that path, but that trend has died out in hardcore, right? And then like, so then we went to like, you know, a more D-beat trend, and then we went to, we had Mysterious Guy Hardcore, then D-beat, and you kind of go into all these different trends, and people think that that's a bad thing, but, I mean, the truth is that it kind of just, like, keeps everything fresh, it just continually rotates. It is kind of a little embarrassing if you're that one annoying guy from every town who plays in every trendy band ever, but, you know, whatever.
like Dr. Dre, until he figured it out.
I don't know enough about Dr. A to comment on that.
He was in, like, a soul group, and then, like, a dance group, and then, like, figured out gangster rap, and he was like, oh, this will make money, all right.
I'm pretty sure, does every town have the one guy who plays, like, guitar in a fucking 80s hardcore revival band, then a DB band, then like a raw punk band, then a mysterious guy hardcore band. And it's like, dude, who are you fucking... Oh, now I'm a tough guy hardcore. It's like, who are you fucking fooling, dude? I've been around long enough to see you playing every fucking trend. Like, what's your deal?
There was definitely a... in the last, you know, 6 or 7 years, there was definitely between like a hardcore boom that also kind of bled into... Do you know what Easycore is?
No, what's that?
Let me show you the world of what pop punk is today. It's a whole, but you know, I don't get too off track. Easycore is a combination of hardcore and pop punk. But here's the thing, it's not a straight up blend. It's like the chorus is like emo pop punk, and then the verses are just this brutal fucking punch in the face breakdown.
Okay.
And it's like, this
is like the buff, like 200-pound dudes who like stage dive the title fight and crush little kids. Is that?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, and by the way, it's not just title fight. It's Newfound Glory has people throwing in the pit.
Glory. Okay, has, like, I know those guys. Yeah, I know those guys.
But it bled so much into it that, like, oh man, and this whole world of pop punk where people are literally saying, unironically, I'm more pop punk than you because the way that punk kids used to do it is, I don't even know.
Okay, so, see, like, people are like, oh, man, your site is so good, blah, blah, blah. But how easy is it to make fun of someone who's going to literally stand there as, like a 25-year-old person and say, I'm more pop-punk than you? Self-embarrassing, dude. Yeah. So it's, like, hella easy.
And I'm not kidding you when I say it's based on, like, they're bragging about that they like pizza more than someone else. Like, I'm not kidding. Like, this is, it's one of those things where I would love to do pitches on it, but like I'm so close to it that it just angers me, and I can't even like see the funny. It's just so well, like the bands
sometimes
that,
those
like
are the best ones, the ones that you're just super close to, because you should pitch them. You should pitch them some easy core stuff.
I will do my best.
Something like, I mean, you could. So one of the things that we do is like, instead of like making it a directly easy core thing and referencing a directly easy core band, you kind of do something like, you know, not this isn't a headline, but like something like some buff guy fucking wrecking some girl wearing a flower crown during a pop punk band or whatever. You know what I mean?
Like, that's imagery.
Like, I guess I think the one thing that I always try to tell our writers is like, show, don't tell, right? Yeah. Show why it's silly or funny. Don't tell us why it's stupid. You know, it's kind of a different. It doesn't sound like
it makes perfect sense, because not only if you tell, then you're
you come off like snarky. You come off like you know everything, and I don't want us to come off like we know everything.
And that's how journalists are supposed to sound. That's where half the funny is. If you sound like a journalist and you say something absurd, it's funny. If you sound like a comedian on a fake news site, you sound like okay, we get it. Yeah, haha.
Yeah. My old editor Mark from SF Weekly, he told me, he was like, I think the main reason why your site is successful is just like the control of tone, which is what you're talking about. Like what we sound like while we're writing these things is very important. Like the fact that it's structured like some form of journalism story, and it sounds like a journalism story, not just, you ever like hear someone go, oh, check out the satire site, and then it's like, I don't know, like some weird like 200-word disjointed thing that like doesn't seem like anything. It seems like some weird fucking blog post or something. I do think tone is very important, which is what you're talking about. I think it's interesting too, because we have a lot of comedians around, right? And comedians use words like bit or routine or setup and punchline, right? And then, but then when we get to the editing phase, because it's like I was the one who started the site or whatever, we use stuff like lead and angle and tone and kicker, so a nut graph, these sorts of things. It's very interesting. Nut graph is an actual thing.
I know, that's why I am, but I'm my 12-year-old in my heart, so yeah. I laughed.
But so, like, I think that's combining of two worlds is kind of like, it's why you don't fuck your cousin. Let me explain. Because you got to diversify the gene pool, right? So you have to have journalists and comedians working together instead of just, you know, fucking your cousin.
Yeah, of course. Okay, I'm going to, another thing. Sex Dolphin, which R. Kelly did a fake song about. I love R. Kelly. And don't fuck, and why you don't fuck your cousin. I always knew not to, but I just kind of went with it because, you know, that's what people say. But also, well, the show don't tell thing is very interesting from a comedy standpoint, because like anytime, and this could just be audiences that differ, but anytime, like, I was always so worried about telegraphing jokes. Uh-huh. And so I'd be like, I don't want to like say something on stage where somebody, so they're going to get the punchline before I say the punchline because I'm making it too obvious. And then, but then people just weren't laughing. I was like, oh, I guess my jokes are bad. And then much more experienced comics that I would ask would just be like, oh, no, they just don't have any idea what you're saying because you haven't led them there yet. I was like, mm-hmm. oh, I feel like they're mm-hmm. never going to telegraph your jokes. Don't even think about that. But here with the show, it's so much more important where it's like you have to feed it to them in one line. You don't mm-hmm. have two paragraphs to mm-hmm. explain to them what the premise is.
One of the things that my favorite comics do, like, I don't know, I've never done stand-up comedy. I don't know very much about it. But one of my favorite things that they do is they lead you somewhere, and then they show you the punchline, and it's some sort of parallel, but it's not actually what you thought, right?
Yes, the misdirection.
It's a misdirection, but then it also is, like, somehow related, and that's always very funny to me.
Well, it's like they have to bring you – absolutely. Well, that's the thing with these bits. You have to bring them into your worldview.
Yeah.
With your references. And it's almost like the invert of these articles where it's like, no, you want to make sure they get it. It's clear. And if they don't already know it, they have to get it through the headline. It's more like they have no idea.
Well, you see like nightly comedians like with talk shows when they do their monologues, they tell you.
Remember this? Recall this?
Yeah, they tell you. They tell you. They're like, "Oh, did you hear Hillary Clinton's? You know, up 10% in the polls." And then they say, "That's not the only thing she's up." Blah 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 blah. Right? So it's like some formats are like kind of set up for that, but I don't think that our format really is. Like, we don't really have time or space to explain something that happened in a headline and then give it a punchline, which limits us in a weird way. But then also, when we decide to say "fuck the limit" and go for it anyways, it kind of like creates this sort of like deep bond with our readership, which I feel like has been one of our one of the best things that's happened over the site. Is like, I feel like some people look at our site, not everyone, there's certainly some people who don't like it, but some people look at our site like it's like their fucking best friend or something, like it's they've known it for their whole life, you know, like, oh my god, this site understands me. And I think that's like we've created a deep bond through the acknowledgement of things that we share in our culture and then joking about them without explaining them.
It legitimizes the culture almost, and it's like, why haven't I seen this a million times before? This has been in the world.
Yeah. We booked Judge. It was awesome because Judge is one of my favorite bands of all time. And one dude from Judge was telling me, he was like, I can't believe that me and my friends didn't come up with this because we've made all these jokes throughout the last fucking 30 years, you know. But you're just like refining them down and popping them out.
Yeah, that's exactly. There's some the amount of times I'd just be like at work and just like scrolling through my phone and I'd see a hard, like, oh, somebody shared a Hard Times article. I'd be like, oh my god, of course.
Yes.
Well, here's the other thing that I thought early on. I was like, I love this site, but what happens when they run out of tropes? Because there was such fresh ground.
Yeah.
The tropes are almost all gone. And it feels so fresh and so creative. Like, did you ever worry about that, or were you just going?
Okay. When we first started, we had like a couple of meetings. We were like, are we gonna run out? Like, we didn't know, right? And we started looking at what we had been running, and we started, you know, planning ahead. And we're like, do we run out, right? And I think the answer is that you can't run out because life continues on, and all we're doing is satirizing alternative life. If we were just satirizing punk, then it would be over, right? Because then you say, okay, you ran a Ramones joke, it's over. You ran a Blink-182 joke, it's over. But that's not what we're doing. So what we're doing instead is that we're becoming an alternative to The Onion, meaning like for people who don't live a standardized life, which I think in our generation is more and more and more.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
People who grew up are growing up as hipsters, or the people who read Vice, or the people who are different, people who go to concerts more often than they go to sporting events or whatever. I think we have like a connection with them that we'll be able to satirize their life and the things that they're going through and grow up with them instead of just satirizing punk. I know that punk is our base, and I know that it's the base of my entire life, but the truth is that no punk is just a punk, you know, and that's not your entire identity. You're a whole lot of other things too, and you have to engage with the rest of the world too.
Yeah.
So there's like so many jokes out there where it's like punks in the office, you know what I mean? And so you can make all these sorts of different, you know.
Absolutely. And I think a lot of the reason the word punk gets thrown around in it, I mean, because it makes sense, especially from it being based.
Yeah, we're punks, you know, so I mean, it makes sense, but.
But I think we just don't have a term for alternative people. I used to just say alternative kids when I wanted to say that whole genre of of exactly what you're describing.
So it sounds like, so it sounds like corny, right? If you're going to say, like, alternative underground music subculture, it sounds fucking corny. It sounds like some weird, like, dude who
has no idea. Whole term for it.
Right, but, I mean, that's what we're doing, though, is we're just doing, so, like, for example, like, if you're, you know, like, so I'm 25. I got into punk when I was like 14 or 15. When you're 14 or 15, you make a whole bunch of friends in the punk scene. We all grew up together. So I can see all the different things that they're doing now, you know, through social media and through talking with them and blah, blah, blah. And we encounter all these things along the way. The fact is, like, punks pay taxes. You know what I mean? So it's so if you want to write a tax joke, they're going to understand that too.
Yeah.
Well, some of them pay their taxes, you know, maybe a little better.
I may have members in my band who have found ways to.
Yeah.
I feel like I've been in so many punk bands with what's the term for it? Just scam artists, basically.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know why, but I keep, maybe it's just me, I keep getting attracted to that group.
Don't let them sucker you in, dude.
I won't use any of their fake coupons or their pyramid schemes. Again, thank you so much for coming on. Is there anything else you wanted to bring up before you jump into any plugs that you have?
No. I don't think I really have any plugs either, you know?
The work speaks for itself.
Hard times fucking rules. I mean, you can check out my band if you want. My band is purestraightedge.com, I think, leads you to our band camp. If not, purestraightedge.bandcamp.com, I'm not sure. We're playing at Gilman pretty soon.
That's so fucking cool. On top of all that, the Gilman connection is so cool. Yeah.
Yeah. The dude who books our shows is one of the bookers at Gilman now. So we actually have a really awesome show that we're planning that I'm super. I can't say it yet, but it's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be called Gilmania. It's the plan is to make it a 2-day thing. It's gonna be called Gilmania because we're big wrestling fans. But yeah.
Oh, I did want to ask one other thing while I got you. The email that people send the general pitches to on the website, the name of it comes up as Hard Tim. Was that a typo, or is that just really funny? I laughed so fucking hard.
The idea is this mascot that we have. The idea is that his name is Hard Tim. When we first started the website, we said we're going to create an advice column where people ask Hard Tim questions, and like every time he's just like, "What would I know? I'm a fucking boot. Do you have a green boot? What would I know about that?" But I guess somehow we got distracted and we decided not to do that. I don't know why that. I think at one point there was an email called like hardtim@gmail.net, and like we had something on our website for like months that was like send Hard Tim an email, and we never checked that account. I should check that account and see what people have, what questions they have. Maybe we should answer them. I don't know.
Pawn it off on site. So what do you do for you work at Hard Times. What do you do for the site? I answer the boot questions.
I answer the boot questions, yeah. I think that we're ready for an advice column. I think that's something that we should do. We're also branching out into video. We have two videos already shot. One of them is a series of like 5 videos, and the other one is like a sketch that we're partnering up with Noisy, and they're going to promote it for us. You know the guy who runs Noisy, the publisher? So like you have like the editor-in-chief, and then you have the publisher, and the publisher is kind of like the business side of things. He toured with Judge, so he's like hardcore dude.
Oh,
so
nice.
He called me up, and he's like, "Yo, dude, Hard Times is sick." Like, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, "Oh, this is awesome."
God, that's awesome. All right, man. Well, for anyone watching, listening, whatever, EricTriesTooHard.com for, all sorts of podcasts. Then again, if you're listening to this, you probably already on the site. If you want to find Matt on Twitter, do you give out your personal Twitter, or is that, I don't know?
Yeah, it's @CaliGirl69. I play video games with my friend, and that was his username. I was like, what the fuck are you doing, dude? It's @MattSaincome, which someone close to me told me is pretentious to use my own name. But so if you want to follow me on Twitter for a whole bunch of pretentious tweets, apparently. You know, @MattSaincome, anytime, man.
Beautiful. All right, well, thanks again for coming on, and I will catch you on the internets, and if anytime you ever want to come back on to have, like, I usually have, like, comic hangs or whatever, I don't know, groups talk about whatever bullshit, feel free to hit me up. I'd have you anytime.
Yeah. Cool, man. I look forward to seeing your pitches.
Yes, me too. I'll catch you later, dude.
Later.